excited to be here. We're going to do two things. Usually I do watch me work, and today I'm going to do watch me play before watch me work, because we're doing, as you all might know, we're doing Father Comes Home from the Wars in the beautiful Loeb Theater, and Stephen Barganetti, who actually plays and sings the songs in the show, is going to come out and join me, and we're going to sing some of the songs. So I've written 5 songs for the show and a lot of music for the show, and he's a genius, and he plays it, so it sounds always really good, and he plays it. But we're going to play it together, 3 of the songs. So we're waiting, because he's in the middle of some great moment in there where they have to sing the stepping with the guitar or something, whatever they're doing. So we're just going to wait for him. So, but I'm glad you all are here, and you've all brought something to work on, or at least some questions about your creative process, or just whatever. There's always room for whatever. So, through the graciousness of HowlRound, and BJ is here from HowlRound, and you guys are at Emerson, where are you guys located?
Oh, here at Emerson College.
At Emerson College, so they're actually located in town. Usually we just live stream from our remote locations when we do it at the public theater, but this time I'm like, yo, y'all are down the street, you can come down, which is great. So you guys are here, and what we do is we basically work together. After we do this little bit here, we're going to work together, and then we're going to talk about your creative process. So, I know the title is, it leads you to understand that the me in the title is actually you. I know, but since this is, you know, Cambridge, Boston, all these smarties, I figure y'all get it right away. I'm just sitting here though. I'm not gonna play a note until Stephen comes. Not one note. I'm just gonna arrange my hair. Very glad to be here. Last time I was here, I was doing Porgy and Bess, the Gershwin's Porgy and Bess, which we had a lot of fun. And very different. That was actually a musical, if any of you happen to see it. And brilliantly done, directed by Diane Paulus, who's the artistic director here. We had so much fun. I thought, I just have to come back and do something else. So I'll write something. So I wrote an enormous play. And they signed up, and we did it first at the Public Theater. And we just finished our run in December. And then we came on up here. So it's been really great. They won't let Stephen out of rehearsal because he's the heart of the show. We started working on Father Comes Home from the Wars back in 2009, a long time ago, with Joe Bonney directing, and none of the original cast members, they've all gone on to do bigger and better things. But way back then, 2009, when we did part 3 in the Shiva, a little tiny theater at the Public Theater in New York City, there was a musician in the show. It was me. I sat on stage and played and sang, but this time, you know, such a big job. And Stephen's such a genius. So we just decided to share the excitement. I'm going to start without it. Is it 4:30? Oh, really? Okay, so Equity says they should release him.
Yeah.
Free him.
A few more minutes,
yeah. Okay. It's okay. We're not, you know.
1 minute.
We're on, yeah. Are you on Horizon Tower time? I know. No. Horizon Tower time. Scary. Yeah. fully because I want to get it right. WBUR the other day, and we did an interview. It's a lot of fun. They don't do, ordinarily, they don't do music on that show, so we kind of shoved ourselves in there, our guitars jamming furiously. It was fun. It was a lot of fun. It's like waiting for Santa. No, I have a 3-year-old and he's just beginning to talk about Santa. So I figured while he was just getting to know Santa, I would have Santa start writing him really long letters about his conduct. Like, is Santa going to bring me? Yes, but you know what? Santa wrote you a letter today. Dear Durham, I've heard you're a very good young man, but I think you need to work on some things. So, so that's what we're doing. By myself, but it's so much more fun to play with Steve.
Is there a story behind your guitar? I've never seen one.
Never seen one like this? This is a, it was my grandfather's guitar, my grandfather Durham. But the story is, the kind of guitar, it's a national, which means it's a resonator, and it's painted in a style called piano or piano, and back in the, it's from the 30s, and back in those days, it was thought fashionable to, do you play a guitar? To paint, it was fashionable to paint metal objects to make them look like wood. So this is actually metal, but it's painted to look like wood. It's a lot of fun to play. I go and play with friends and stuff, or strangers, and they always see me taking it out, and they're like, oh, no. And they hear it, and they're like, that sounds really strange, because they think it's wooden, when in fact it is not. So that's, yeah, so they made, you know, you see the nationals most often, they're silver, you know, they're silver colored, and they have very beautiful and elaborate, what do you call it, stencil sketch, you know, whatever, those carvings, engraved, they're engraved very beautifully, like with palm trees, or, I'm just warming up. See, it's much more fun with that. But yeah, so it's called Piana. This is it's really heavy.
Yay! He's here.
Hey, the fabulous Stephen Barganetti, football. Yay!
Thank you. So happy to be playing with the fabulous Suzan-Lori Parks.
Okay. Just I told him you were in rehearsal, and because you're the heart of the show, they won't let you go. So be like,
I don't know about all of that. You know, we're working for Taskmaster.
We're working for the Taskmaster. Joe Bonney. Joe Bonney's a brilliant director. If you ever want to play or anything directed brilliantly, call up Joe Bonney. She's from Australia, so you can enjoy her accent. And she's in there just making it more better. How are we with the light, Jerry? We're good?
It's good.
Maybe you need to, I know you're fine.
Should I just like double check?
Yeah,
just give me an E chord?
Yeah, I think I'll start on the E chord. So sure, I'll just give a little intro to you. We're going to do 3 songs. The first song, so the title, you know, Father Comes Home from the Wars. The play is basically about a guy whose master, he's a slave in the 1860s, and the master says, I'll give you your freedom if you come to the war with me. Come to the war as my valet, basically. This is the Confederate side we're talking about. And so the first play deals with him thinking about that and trying to decide what to do. And spoiler alert, yeah, by the end of the first play in the trilogy, he's made a decision, and this song comes up.
Darkness of the darkest night, there's still
So Watch Me Work is, it's two things. It's a meta-theatrical, well maybe it's just one big thing. It's a meta-theatrical free writing class, okay? It's a play, first and foremost. So it's a play where we create the action together by working together, and then together we create the dialogue by talking after our work session about your work and your creative process. That's the most important thing about it. It's about your work and your creative process, okay? So what we're gonna basically do is we're all gonna work on this timer. I brought my timer today. I still have my guitar pick on, so I'm multitasking. So I brought the timer, I'm gonna set the timer. There are a lot of people here today, so I'm gonna set the timer for 20 minutes, okay? And we're gonna work together for 20 minutes, and then we're going to have Q&A where you can ask me questions about your work and your creative process. And if that seems confusing, we'll figure it out when we get there. It's very easy. People all around, people in Amsterdam. we do this. So I know y'all can do it here. Okay. No, but so that's basically what we'll do. And because we're live streaming, thank you, HowlRound. And should I say we're A.R.T. in the lobby of the Loeb Theater at A.R.T. in Cambridge. We're so happy to be here. And thanks, Vijay, behind the camera. Thanks, Mark, who's my sidekick, or riding shotgun, like Steve McQueen and Neil Brenner. So we're going to, if we're live streaming, and folks who want to tweet us questions, as they often do, can tweet to?
They can tweet to @AmericanRep. Oh. Should I come to the front?
Yeah.
Hi. They can tweet to?
Come to the light. There you go.
Find your light. They can tweet to @AmericanRep, AmericanRep, and use the hashtag #NewPlay. They will get your questions on this thing and pass them on.
Could you say it again slowly
for
people?
Yes. Twitter handle is AmericanRep, and use the hashtag #NewPlay.
Great. Okay. Great. And if you if you forget that, then just hold your questions for when we do it in New York, and we'll figure it out then. Okay. Or just watch. Because probably what always happens is somebody, you know, in the audience is going to ask the very question that you want to ask, and we'll pretend it's about you. Okay, so we're going to do first. It's going to work. We're going to set a timer. We're going to work, and then we're going to get. Then we're going to talk. All right. Okay. Oh yeah, and I'm going to write. For those of you who don't know what this is, it's a typewriter, and provided by a wonderful gentleman. Who's the guy? Mark number one. Mark. Big Mark, who's the guy who gave us this typewriter? Do you remember?
His name is John, at Cambridge Typewriter in Arlington. It's like right on that side.
Yeah, so if you want a gorgeous typewriter, go to Cambridge. This is it's beautiful. So I'm gonna use this. And those of you who are bothered by the noise, just pretend it's, you know, the voice of history. I hear the voice of history. Oh, yes.
Please, paper?
Oh, yeah, you may. Yes, anybody need any paper? Look, we have lots
of
paper.
Thanks.
You can pass. Sure, anybody who needs paper? Anything else anybody need? I don't have a pen. I won't share my pens. All right, ready? Okay, I'm going to set the timer for 20 minutes. Does that sound good? Does anybody feel any anxiety about working for 20 minutes? Okay, good. See, we've already done. We're already successful here. I'll wait till you get seated. Cool. How's the apples look in the shop?
Looks great.
Looks like still life or something. Mm-hmm. Okay, here we go. Let's begin.
Thank you.
part of our play that we just completed, and that was the action part, and now we're going to do the dialogue part. So any of you, if you do, have, I'm going to use the mic so I have video, have, thank you, have, we're going to move back, no, I'm going to sit right here.
That's the music for this part.
You're not the musical director. Thank you, Mark. So anybody who has, if you have questions about your work or your creative process, now's time.
Once I'm clear about what it is I'm doing,
yes,
it's okay, and I can start to kind of think visually and write out of that.
Yes.
What do you do when you can't get clear?
Yes, excellent question. What's your name?
Bill.
Bill, thank you, Bill. That's a brilliant question. And I'm sure it's a question a lot of us have. It's a question I have, like, every day. Yeah, so what I find is helpful, and maybe this will be helpful to you, and I'm sure you do it already, just put the time in, you know? I mean, do you put the time in on a regular, I don't even know what your work you're talking about, but what kind of work are you talking about in this case?
In the past, I've written plays, like a lot of plays,
and I haven't done it so much lately, and I'm working on a film now.
Okay, great. So, that's very good. I find it very helpful to put the time in, regardless of my level of clarity. See, and I really, that's why I brought this, I mean, I have, anybody who knows me, they come over to my apartment or whatever. See, I have like 10 of these for different things. I have, it's not my phone, you know, it is an actual timer designated for just that purpose. And I set it really when I'm not feeling very clear about what I'm working on. I set it and I put some time in. And depending on your schedule, you know, you have responsibilities, family, another job, or whatever, you know. You might not be able to put the time in at the same time every day, okay? You know, some books say, put the same time, you know. Do what you can, but really, if it feels like, remember we were scratching that table, it's actually great that happened. It feels like that sometimes to work. You know, 10 minutes is a good amount of time. If you can't stand 10 minutes, 5 minutes is a really good amount of time. You know, or 20 minutes is a good amount of time. And sometimes you just sit there and maybe write in your journal or turn on your computer and just, I'm not clear yet, but you know, you're in the wilderness basically, which is a very important part of the creative process. So celebrate that you're in the wilderness. Because that's where everything is, man. You know what I'm saying? If it were all like a paved road, you know what I mean? It would be like, right? But you are in the wilderness, and that's the part that we fight against. We think, darn, you know? Something's wrong. It's difficult. I'm not in a clearing. Nah, you're in the thick of it. You're in the bushes. Yeah, remember, how do we find things? We beat the bushes, because that's where the shit is, man. It's not in the bushes, man. There you are, you're in the bushes. Yay. So set your timer, you know. I do, and I'm in the bushes and in the wilderness a lot in my work. You know, I find myself in the wilderness a lot. So I just set the timer, and I make sure I put the time in. And the clarity comes. You know, Lewis and Clark, you know, they got there. They had a lot of help, too. And you'll find that there are going to be guides and helpers along the way. You know. Is that helpful?
Yeah.
Really. And just know that you're not alone. I'm right there with you, man, my little Radio Shack kind of. Yes, ma'am, right there.
Thank you. I don't know if you work with a typewriter all the time, but is there something about the sound of the typewriter that works as a goad for you? Because for me, you know, sometimes when you sleep with someone, you want to be in sync with their heartbeat. Sometimes we don't want to be, but it just just happens naturally.
Right.
I felt that way working in the room. Like I felt like when the typewriter stopped, I wanted to take a breath. So, yeah.
I use a variety of things. I mean, and when I do my show in New York, I use a typewriter. Sometimes I have my iPad or my phone or a pad and paper, you know. So I use a number of different things, you know, the regular computer. But if for the show, I find it very helpful to use the typewriter, yeah, as sort of the, it's the music. You know, it's the score, really, for me. But sometimes I will, you know, switch out in this, doing this play and use my iPad, which is my, you know. But yeah, it's a beautiful thing. Do you have a typewriter?
I don't.
It's great. I mean, even if you have one and it's, you use it just sometimes, you know, we can restart the art of letter writing. You know, it's great that, you know, I mean, letter, actually to open a piece of paper that's been sent through the hands of possibly disgruntled postal workers. Possibly, or wonderful postal workers, because, you know, they're awesome people. And to open this a letter, or write letters to yourself, or the act, it's a physical act. I mean, I love it, augmenting my writing practice with a variety of physical activities. Guitar playing, it's the same kind of thing. I'm doing this, you know, typing this. And you're thinking with both sides of your, you're working with both sides of your brain, you know, instead of just one. So it's fun just to get one. They're not expensive. And where was that store?
Cambridge Typewriter. It's in Arlington.
And he has a variety of beautiful, I was kind of beginning to covet this. I was kind of going, can I take that home? I see people, they notice. It's stunning. This is a gorgeous one. Anybody else? Yes.
Yeah, so that's connected to like labels and compartmentalizing. So I'm rehearsing for a play that I'm the writer and the performer.
Oh, cool.
And I'm just having trouble separating, but I'm getting to a point now where I'm like, should I even separate? And what's the point of it? Because I was surprised to see that you played guitar. I had no idea.
Yeah.
So when you're playing guitar, are you thinking, here I am, the musical director, oh wait, don't think about, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I just think like a while ago before I even started doing theater, like professionally, I was just kind of like, oh yeah, like I just do what I can do, it's whatever.
Right.
But now when you're in like production, it's kind of like, okay, are we talking about the script over here? Are we talking, you know what I mean? So I'm trying to figure out inner and also outward how to figure, how to like manage.
Yeah, that's a great question for those of us who do many different things. And we all do many different things, really. I mean, you're doing it in the professional world, but we all, you know, if you're a parent, if you have another job to augment your other job, whatever that is, so we're all always doing different things. I think it's important to learn to distinguish, and to learn to distinguish when you need to distinguish. So when I'm up here playing guitar, I'm not thinking about anything, actually. It's strange, you know. I'm not thinking about anything. I'm just up here sort of letting it move. But when I'm sitting down, I don't know, the other night I went to boil some eggs and I got to writing in the, I mean, have you ever burned boiled eggs? I was like writing and going, the eggs are boiling and the pot was boiling and it was sad. So learn to, when to be mindful about many things, and learn just when to focus and let it flow through you. If you're in production and you're in a production room and they have a question about the music, you have to put on your other hat and go down there and answer the question. In Father Comes Home from the Wars, Stephen Barganetti is our musical director, so I do not have to do that, yay! And Joe Bonney is our director, so I have to do that, yay! And we have fabulous actors, yay! So all I do is sit around and go, buh, 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 buh. You know, and just make sure the words are being said in the right order. So if you're always distinguishing and always splitting, then you're not going to be as effective. But you do need to split and distinguish it some times of the day.
I'm sort of following up on that. I'm curious how you let one art form feed the other. Like, I get the distinguishing part, but then how does the music feed the writing, feed the, how do those nourish one another?
Yeah. Well, how about you? I mean, do you do other art? Do you do more than, are you a more than one? Are you a hyphenate? Are you a slash?
I'm more a wannabe.
You're a wannabe. No, but really, what were we working on just now?
It was actually, I was actually listing all the artistic endeavors that I have, I'm not pursuing. It was sort of free writing about, what's preventing me from doing, I'm sort of in my own life transition, having just finished being an executive director.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you. But continuing to work as a consultant, so I'm trying to find my way to more artistic, yeah.
And what's keeping you from?
Well,
what did you say? What did you say, journal? What is your journal say? What does the oracle say? The oracle knows.
The oracle knows. Well, I was really questioning what prevents me. And I got into how wired I am to be in another way. I'm sort of wired to be an executive. I'm not wired to be an artist. What prevents me from diving into it? Like all that, that's exactly what I was getting to. And sort of deluding myself that I don't have the time, but actually do have the time. I like it like that.
But those are all really important things to talk about, or at least touch on. You know, the way we convince ourselves that we shouldn't do what we really, really do want to do, really.
Yeah.
You know, if you're, you know, the way you say you're wired to be an executive, and not, which means that you're telling yourself really that you're not wired to be
an artist, even though my work requires a lot of design and a lot of like that.
Right. Well, it's a natural thing. I mean, for, you know, several years you've been praised and lauded as an executive. Okay, so you're in the habit of being.
Right.
Okay, it's just a development of nurturing of habits, you know. You just have to nurture those habits. And you nurture, how do we nurture those habits that are, we're not in the habit of nurturing, really.
Right.
You know,
right.
Especially when we have achieved success in another field. It's very, I mean, as a, I don't know many writers, I know some, but not many, who actually write songs and perform them. I don't know many who play guitar and sit, no, I don't know many. It requires a real desire and love to say, I'm gonna play music too. You know, I also write novels, I'm gonna write novels too. People will go, no, don't. You're a playwright.
Right.
You know what I mean? You're wired to be a playwright. Says who?
Yeah, right.
You know, I'm in the habit of doing that, you know.
Yeah.
So you have to just encourage yourself, and it really starts with yourself. And if you start looking toward, you know, spouse or friendship circle or whatever to give us the encouragement, I think we're asking the wrong source. You have to ask for yourself to encourage yourself, and you encourage yourself by putting the time in every day. I mean, really, that's what's so corny. It's just 20 minutes a day. Just sit down and write in your journal. That's all. That's all you need to do. And it'll start to, there will come a point where it reaches its hand out to you and says, hold my hand, come on, let's go. You know, everything I've ever written, I put the time in, I'm lost, I'm in the wilderness, I put the time in, at a certain point, it extended its hand to me. I said, okay, kiddo, come on. And we fly. You've seen Cocteau, Beauty and the Beast, you know, where they fly? Anyway, you gotta see it, just for the end. They fly in the end, you know, it's really cool. Your work, your creative work, the work you long to do, will reach its hand out to you and say, come on. Let's fly now. If you put the time in, I think. And sometimes it will strike you, you know, you'll be in the middle of just minding your own business, it'll grab you. But, you know, if you want the consistent sort of companionship of your own self and a meditation practice, put in a plug for a meditation practice. If you don't have one, it's still, you know, still January, you have time. You know, 10 minutes just sitting. If you don't feel comfortable sitting on the floor, you know, cross-legged and like, you know, full lotus, and it's okay. You know, in a chair, you know, we'll do it with a timer again. People just admit it. They go, well, I don't use a timer. I just you know. No. I just meditation practice. So, just put the time in and let those things come up. Oh, you're not supposed to be a. Yeah. I've heard all before. People tell me I wasn't supposed to be a writer. Oh well. Maybe I'm not supposed to be a writer. Maybe I'm supposed to be a ballet dancer.
Oh, yeah.
Or, you know, in The Lion King, my son calls these my Lion King boots. You weren't signaling me.
No, we have one though.
Okay. Well, gentlemen here, and then we'll go to you. Great.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
No. These people are on Twitter. We'll have to wait.
So we've talked a lot about time, but I'm like,
yes.
I was struck here about space. Like, I was hauling out to a space to work in, and like, it took me longer to get here than the entirety of this whole, you know, event is going to be, you know? So I was struck by, like, the idea, like, I'm coming to a space, and, like, how do I create that space outside of this space? Because I don't think I've written really since the last time you did this at Emerson, or since I was in workshops. Yeah. So
glad you're here.
Yes, of course. Wouldn't miss it. And I'm about to do a big move, actually, to another location, and
okay.
I want to be able to create a space where
okay.
it's more creatively generative.
Yeah, that's a good, just, I'll just make a big global statement, which will cover part of this. Anything that tells you that you shouldn't be doing what you know in your heart you really want to do, you know, something beautiful is not going to hurt anybody, you know what I'm talking about. Any voice that tells you you shouldn't be doing it, you don't have the space, you're hardwired, you're lost, mm-hmm. bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
Just because it will come up, that voice manifests itself in a variety of ways, in a way that is best suited to get to your shit.
Yeah.
Push it
right, right.
You know, someone told me that you're hardwired, you're not hardwired, but that's not going to work with me. But they might tell me something else is going to get to me. So, yeah, your space isn't appropriate for you. That's going to get to you. So, know that you can find the space. And I make space. I have a 3-year-old, and we live in a very small apartment. So, how do you make the space? I don't have my own, you know, gorgeous office with a, you know, servant who brings me tea or whatever. I don't know. Think of though Jane Austen, right? Didn't she write? I read that she wrote, you know, she kind of would hide it in her lap when folks, because she didn't want folks to get on to the fact she's a brilliant writer. All throughout the ages, you know, think of the slave narratives or people writing in secret where it was outlawed, or things like we can find you a place. What's helpful is to get yourself things that might help you create a place. Get a timer that's not your phone.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
This is dorky looking on purpose. It's not cutesy, it's not expensive, and it's not my phone. Okay? Get some, I have them here, I won't show them to you because they're dirty. Get some earplugs. Not the earbuds. Earplugs, you know, they're orange or some dorky color. They sell them in the drugstore. Suddenly, with this and your earplugs, any Starbucks is an amazing place to write. It's quiet. Suddenly quiet. Get yourself a, you know, if you like to drink coffee, some, you know, novel, some other. Okay, there you go, an adult beverage. And you go and you set up at a table, you know. A lot of my writing I do in public places, you know. Diners are great, you know. When the roommates, if you have roommates, when they're gone. When my son is in daycare. My writing period used to start at 5 a.m. I have a 20-minute writing time that starts at 7 a.m. in my notebook, and I've taught him, when he sees me at the desk doing this, Mommy's writing, I'm not allowed to talk to her. And so he says, but I can write with her, right? And I say, yes, honey, come on, sit next to me. And we write together. He's left-handed, so he has to sit like over there. but you know, so you teach your roommates and the people you live with and love. My writing time is this. When you see me writing, understand that I'm... So there's a little bit of work that has to go into it. But it's totally doable. And just tell yourself, you know, like they used to say in the old days, you know, ain't nobody gonna turn me around. Get cool with it, get real with it. You know, you can do it.
Cause you've come all this way. You've made it this far.
The world is counting on you. Don't we realize that? We do realize that, right? The world is depending on us to do our thing. World is depending on us. I mean, imagine if everybody did like beautiful, loving, wonderful things that came from their heart and weren't held back and felt like they had to, really. I mean, the world is depending on us to do our wonderful things. Fill the world with beautiful things. You know? And when we liberate ourselves from our shit, others around us are liberated too. Our kids are liberated, our friends are liberated, our colleagues are encouraged. You know, it's a good thing. So it's not just a selfish kind of thing that you only do it for yourself. You know, yourself meaning the big S, which is everybody, even out there. Speaking of, yes.
Yeah, this is actually a semi-similar question. It comes from Molly, who is watching from Dallas.
Molly in Dallas! I know Molly in Dallas.
I do. Yes, I do.
She wants to ask, when you're in a new place, how do you keep your routine?
So good. Well, I have to give a little 5-second talk about Molly, who is a wonderful writer and director. And I initially met her because we worked on the show Watch Me Work in New York City. And she most recently was the assistant director on Father Himself of the Wars. Traveled to Dallas to direct a production down in Dallas. So very excited. So Molly, keep on. She's in a new place. She's got a lot of responsibilities, and she's wondering how to keep her routine. Put your foot down and smile, both things. So you have to be a hard ass by saying, this is my schedule, this is what I'm doing. And like with my son, I mean, he doesn't like, oh, mommy's writing, oh no, you know? He's like, mommy's writing, it's a game. He gets his paper and we write together. I get my writing done though. I get my writing done. In the morning I do yoga, he comes in, mommy's doing yoga. I'm gonna do some yoga too, he says. He does some yoga too, right? But he knows the routine. And he's 3. So we can teach ourselves, okay, so maybe in the morning you want to get up and go running. I don't know, I know Molly runs marathons, so that's important to keep up running. Just know that you're worth it. And if you don't think so, just believe me. You don't have to believe yourself, just believe me. You're worth it, we're all worth it, right? You set your schedule, decide on what your schedule is. My schedule, I get up in the morning, I meditate, then I do 20 minutes of yoga, and then I do 20 minutes of writing. Then I get my son dressed and I take him to school and I come back and I do more writing. But that's scheduling around a 3-year-old. Okay, some of us, we don't have 3-year-olds. You know, just set your schedule, write down a list of what your schedule is. It sounds simple, but just stick to it. I don't know, it's hard. I'll text you and I'll talk to you. Yes?
I had a question about voice and influence.
Yes.
So, I read a lot, and I think that reading makes me a better writer.
Yes.
But
yes.
When I read something and like it and start writing because I'm inspired to, I kind of start writing similarly to what I'm reading, and so I feel like my own voice is getting lost in it. Mm-hmm. And I wonder how to avoid that influence without, you know, suffocating that inspiration as well.
Suffocating the inspiration you get from reading other writers.
Yeah.
Right. I hear what you're saying. I make a radical idea. Just to try. So are you working? Are you writing something right now? Are you in the middle of writing something?
Mm-hmm.
And are you reading things as well?
Mm-hmm. They're really different from that thing.
Stop reading.
Okay.
Radical. Stop reading for a little while.
Mm-hmm.
Take a break.
Yeah.
Take a little bit of a break. Because you've identified the what you consider to be a problem, right? So stop it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just let it go. Because I think you've identified what you consider to be a problem, and the reason why you keep reading, it sounds to me, because you believe that your source of inspiration comes from that thing you read, which I will tell you is not correct. So how can I stop breathing? That's my inspiration. That's my breath right there. That book, that novel, that wonderful graphic novel, that poem, that song, whatever. That's where your breath comes from? No. Your breath comes from you. It comes from inside you. It's not to say that you're not influenced. We're not all influenced by the world and fill in the blank, right? But it's you. It's you. So let go of that. Know that your inspiration, your breath, comes from you. It's something that you make and generate, and listen in rather than out for a while. You see? And then when you come to the end, you're finished with your thing, then go and gorge and have a feast. You know what I mean? And then let it go again and come over here and write your thing. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Okay? Okay. Good. Good question.
you're writing a character whose experience is radically different than yours, mm-hmm. whether they mm-hmm. are from a different place, mm-hmm. or they look different, or mm-hmm. they're a woman and you're a man, something that I struggle with
yes.
is making that character unique and true to who they are.
Right.
And my there's like having their past inform them and their actions and how they talk and speak.
Yes.
And then there's caricatures and weird stuff that's wrong and weird. And
yes.
my baseline that a couple different teachers have given me
yes.
is spend as much time with them, learn as much as about you can about them, talk to a person, whether maybe they're black, maybe they're Russian, maybe they're Polish, whatever.
Right.
Get to know what their voice is.
Right.
But a thing that I struggle with is there, and I was wondering, can you speak about that? I struggle with that, and like,
yeah.
what do you do when you're writing someone whose experience is really different from yours?
Yeah.
Without being like fake.
Right. I would say that it's a great question, and it's a question that we, you know, if you want to, some people just write about themselves, you know what I mean, all the time. Their autobiography over and over and over, and some of us don't, and I'm one of the writers, I don't. One of my favorite writers, Shakespeare, as far as I know, didn't. And he might have been, you know, Hamlet, but he wasn't Hamlet and Lear, and Richard the Third, and Henry the Fourth, and the Fifth, and the Sixth, and the Eighth. Right, you know what I'm saying? So
yeah.
he, you know what I'm, so he was writing about people who were not him. Okay, great. They all might be like white guys, but that's kind of like not, you know, they weren't like him, right?
Okay. Yeah.
So, and I take a lot, I learn a lot from reading him. And what I find is that the, what makes a character isn't often what people think. You have to get really specific. Like in Father Comes Home, there's the Colonel, who's a white guy in the 1800s, you know. I didn't do like research. I just listened. Because a part of me, because he was a character, one of my characters, there must be a part of me that is a part of him. There has to be.
Yeah.
It's like the Shakespeare model is old, right? I mean, there's a part of me that's a part of him. We're connected. And what is that? That's what I wrote about.
Yeah.
You know? From that understanding. From that place of compassion and interest and love and wonder. You know, I was leaning into him, so I would listen to him, really listen to him. I would say that if I wanted to write about, I don't know about going to talk to someone who is of that particular group, because forgive, you know, think about, like, I want to write about people in Ireland, I'm going to talk to an Irish person, but the experience is so wide and diverse
yeah.
that that's not a guarantee that you're going to get, you know.
Yeah.
To the heart of it. What is the story you want to tell? And how does the character fit into it? And read more Shakespeare. Do you read a lot of Shakespeare? There you go. So reread them. And it's wonder. Dickens also. Same thing.
Sure.
You know? Shaw? Shaw. I thought you said sure. Shaw.
Sure.
Shaw. Oh, that's right. Y'all talk funny up here. Shaw. But yes, Shaw, exactly. So there, anybody else can think of any writers who were like, who wrote beautifully about people who were not them? And that's the thing. Who are we?
Yeah.
That's the question that I keep
yeah.
asking. I mean, people say like, what are your plays about? My plays are, who are we and what are we doing here? Who
yeah.
are we really? You know, you look in the mirror, you think, I am, and you can list in the census, you check in boxes, really. But really, who are we? You know, and if I say, yeah, I'm a, this box, this box, this box, and I'm limiting myself. And I'm just a playwright, and I'm limiting myself. Not just a playwright, but, you know, a playwright. I'm limiting myself.
Yeah.
But if I start thinking, I am here, okay, and what else, you know? So, but you have to be very respectful also when you write about people who are not you.
Yeah.
Incredibly respectful. You have to come at it with maybe more love than you would come at it if you're writing about the members of your own family. It actually requires more love and more compassion and more muscles, more craft muscles, artistic craft muscles, not craft generally. Yes?
So I've got a question.
when you're writing, you have lots of ideas that you want to incorporate into it. And
right.
when you have a new idea, it's new and shiny and exciting. How do you find which ideas are best to be filled out, which ideas to pursue, which stories are worth telling, and which are just shiny for the moment and
right.
not worth that?
Right. So you have. It sounds like you have a lot of ideas. A lot of ideas.
Yep.
You're trying to figure out which one to put your energy into for
exactly.
a period of time.
Exactly. So that it doesn't become like a big, like crazy mishmash of incoherence.
Right. Right. So yeah. So it's not. You're not trying to write or do 20 things at once.
Yeah.
Which one? Which one do you like the most? Which one calls to you the most? Which one has the most heat? Which one feels like the most fun? You know, go where the fun, Joseph Campbell, the great writer, follow your bliss,
Right, we've all heard that. And what does it mean? I don't know what it means. I'm never sitting back here thinking about it. Just
go for the one that you like the best, You have some ideas and you think, write them down maybe in your notebook and think, well, which one do I really, 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 really want to do? Can I fit, which one do I want to have like 20 pages of by the end of the month? And this one can be second, and this can be third. Think of like an airport, planes on the runway. They're not all going to take out at once. No, they're going to line up. So put them in a line. Order them, and be patient with yourself. And if you work on one and it loses its, then maybe you might want to start working on another one. I would suggest you try to finish one. That's the key, Work to it, go to the end, and then maybe start another one. So you have like first drafts of maybe four or five different things, and then second drafts of four or five different things. That's the way to work. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
Okay. And know that you don't have to finish it, like do a full, complete, ready to send to the publisher draft of something. You can do a first draft of something, then move on to another project, and do a first draft of something else, move back to the first project, do a second draft of that one, and jump back and forth between two or three different projects that way. I do that a lot, because I work on several different things. In rotation, I call the lazy Susan. Your mom might have one of those things in the kitchen. Or the dim sum. Anybody? Yes?
So, you've mentioned that we have to push against the voice that tells us that we cannot do things and like put our time. Or where do you get the strength to find that confidence when there's moments when you don't think you can do it,
right.
and there's other things that feel like they're more important. Where do you find the strength to be like, no, I'm
right.
okay, I can do this?
That's a great question. Where do you find the strength? What's your name?
Aida.
Aida. Oh, like the opera.
Yes.
Oh, wow. My dad loved the opera. Aida. So where do you find the strength to push against or to work past that voice that says, shouldn't you be doing something else? Or you're hardwired to be, whatever. You ought not be doing this. It's a habit. It's so simple. See, we think that it's just this big, enormous, oh my God thing that you have to be born with or whatever, have to have the right teachers, or you didn't go to the right school, blah, blah. It's just a habit. So you get in the habit of, like, what habits do you have already? Yeah, good habits that you
what do you want? I cook and I play guitar too.
You play guitar? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So you're in the habit every day of playing the guitar?
I try to, yeah.
Okay, great. Okay, so you're in the habit every day of playing the guitar, we'll say. Or at least every other day.
Yeah.
So the development of habits, it's a transferable skill. Do you go to school? Do you go to class? Do you go to, what do you do?
Actually, I'm a student here.
You're
a
student.
In the drama program.
In the drama, so you're really smart. So no, but you're in the habit of reading texts.
Yes.
Okay. Just know that your habits are transferable. A good habit is a transferable skill. The development of a good habit is a transferable skill. You see what I mean? So it's like someone who needs to go to the gym, for example, and they don't really want to go to the gym, but they're really great at every day they get up and they play their guitar for an hour. They develop the ability to stick to something and work hard. You can transfer that onto something else. So just put the time in and don't, again, we're old timers. This timer or one kind of like it. Digital's nice,
Okay, I'm just plugging it.
But again, it's not your phone. You get into the habit of sitting down and dealing with that voice that tells you, shouldn't you be doing something else? You get into the habit of dealing with it. Just like if you read text, you're a dramaturgy student. Shit, more power to you. Shit, now I've got to read. Oh my God. You know, you get into the habit of like, grrr, I'm going to read this and underline and make sense of this idea or whatever. Whatever you guys do, I'm not sure. but you know what I'm saying? You've developed that skill. All you do is just develop the habit. It's not like magical. Or it is actually, it's magical and it feels miraculous. But it's a, like the loaves and the fishes. I think he just had a knife and cut things up and everybody shared. It was called a miracle. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's manageable. You know, and sure, I mean, every writer I know, every artist I know has those voices that come up. Every professional person, lawyers, artistic directors, doctors, everybody I know who, you know, is somebody in their job, you know what I mean, or has achieved some kind of success, still has voices of, you ought not do this, who do you think you are, blah, blah, blah. But we're in the habit of continuing. It's a habit. It's a practice. We practice continuing every day as often as we can. And that's something that everybody can learn. So there you go. Good question. That's a really good question. Anybody else? Yes.
So I'm working on a play.
Yes.
And I have a bunch of scenes
yes.
that I like.
Good.
But I'm having trouble figuring out a way to make them into a thing, and it's not just scenes. So when you're working on a play, how do you find that way to connect what you have to make a fluid piece?
So that's a good question. What's your name?
Eva.
Eva?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Eva. Always pretty names today. Is it a story in the traditional sense, or?
It's more like a collection of scenes that I'm trying to find a through line, like I'm not sure if they should exist in the same universe.
Right.
Right now it's kind of the theme of like interactions between strangers.
Uh-huh, okay.
Yeah.
So, but you think, I want to have an order for these scenes,
yeah.
I want to have it to sort of move in a certain way, I want to have, so physically, where did the scenes, I mean physically meaning you typed them out?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and where do they exist now that you've typed them out? Physically, not like on the stage they would be set in, but right now, if you were to hold them in your hand, what would you be holding on to?
Like where the...
Like paper?
Oh, no, they're not printed.
They're not printed?
No.
Okay, so where are they?
In Dropbox.
In Dropbox, okay, but are they printable?
Yes.
Okay, great, okay, it's interesting that you're having this issue and this, So you print them out, right? Are they really long scenes or relatively short?
No, not particularly long.
Okay. Do you like colors or are you more of a plain white paper person?
I like colors.
Great. That's what I figured. I was guessing. Okay. So you might do a couple of different things. You might go to the store and print them out first and get them printed, right? So they're printed. And then you go to the store or to your nearest stationery closet that allows you to pilfer. And you, if you're a student, I don't know what your means are, but you borrow some index cards, fairly, the large kind, not the 3x5, although those are good, but if you're writing scenes, maybe you want something a little bigger, or try the smallest, depending. And you have a wall in your home. That you can maybe stick them. I'm just asking. You might live in a yurt and you can't put anything on the wall. You might live in a field. I don't know. You might be out in the land or something. Can you put like push pins in the wall? Or?
Yeah.
Well, great. Okay. So you what you can do is take the scenes. You got them physical. They're physical
mm-hmm.
because you're trying to sort of come back down to earth with them instead of having them all in Dropbox. You're on the cloud. Good. So we're going to land, okay? So you're going to write down what happens in each scene on one of these colored cards. So you take your index cards. You write down, like, Jane is doing a headstand, and Mark, or not Mark, we have too many Marks in here, and Joanna comes in and she does the dance of the seven veils, whatever this is. Okay, and you write that down in your own handwriting, like a quick blip of the scene, like a snapshot, right? And you put them, you start putting them on the wall. So you involve your body, touching them, tactile, old form of, you know, old school, right? And you start, and you have them up on your wall, and you can start to move them around, right? And see, like, oh, maybe this is, would be a great way to start the play. Oh, I'm gonna take this one. Oh, cool. Oh, I think we need a song there. I'm gonna write a song about Joanna. There. Right? Not Visions of Joanna by Bob Dylan, but another song. And then I'm gonna put, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So you start to get physical with it. Right? Because it sounds like it's very beautiful, but very sort of up in the cloud, right? And see if it starts to come together like that. Or at least it'll be fun to work on like that, you know?
Thank you.
Sure, try that and see. It might be fun. And if it doesn't work, oh well. But you will have some really nice colored cards with you. Thanks. Anybody else? Oh, yes, sir.
So a follow-up. Why is it important to stop after 20 minutes?
Measurable. 20 minutes for here, you know, when I'm at home it's longer. This morning I wrote for, you know, for an hour. But I had to stop after an hour because I had to come to rehearsal, see? So 20 minutes at home when I'm at home with my son because, you know, he's three and we're pushing it with 20 minutes, you know. He's great, but after 20 minutes. It's a manageable time, you know. That's the important thing. It's a great question. It's the important thing about time. We don't want to set ourselves a, you know, I'll write for 5 hours. So I have all weekend. I'll put in 10 hours a day. And then we freak the fuck out. We're screaming, running, you know, through the streets. You know what I mean? Because, right, who in their right mind, I mean, some people do, but if we've been having difficulty writing, then it is a huge, enormous goal. So I set myself manageable goals. I have a saying, I just lower the bar. That's how I get my work done. Really. Just lower the bar. Oh, it's too high. Okay. And it's all the way flat. Look, oh, I can walk away. Success. Really. A lot of days, it's just like that. I just keep lowering the bar until I can manage to do something. And something gives me encouragement to continue. And I continue. And I get in the habit of continuing. And then I feel, oh, good, I got something done today. So much of my work, I'd say almost, you know, everything I've written or made has been like that. Always in the wilderness, always lost, always taking little tiny steps most of the time. And then when we're in rehearsal, it's like, you know, because there they are, they're working, and I'm just dancing around, you know. But yeah, it's a man. So 20 minutes is manageable, you know, for me today. Anybody else? Yes, in the back.
Do you have any thoughts/slash advice on exploring like new a form that's not really your common style of writing or performing and like going into like new territory? Any advice for?
Yeah. What's what you want to be? Can you be specific? Or?
Yeah. So I'm also a dramaturg.
Okay.
And I'm working on a devised piece coming up, and I've worked on devised pieces before, but I'm much more invested in the actual creation this time.
Uh-huh.
So a lot of the work I've done previously has been more of like a traditional, in a sense, narrative approach to it. So I'm kind of looking to explore a new territory.
Like non-traditional narrative?
Yeah. like a less traditional narrative. And also like the new kind of collaborative process of the devised work.
Right. Well, it sounds like you have a team already.
Yes.
A team assembled.
Yeah.
And well, where are you where's your sticking point? It sounds like you're like off to the races.
We're off to the races. I guess my thought is that I'm having a hard time translating. Like, I think a lot in shapes, and I'm having a lot of hard time translating the shapes into stage picture. right. in terms of structure. And since it's a new structure, I'm having a hard time kind of getting over that gap.
So you think in terms of shapes, like what kind of shape? Like this, like traditional shape, like square, like circle?
More like mapping things out.
Like mapping?
Yeah,
aside?
Like mapping things out and like visualization.
So you want, and what you'd like to have when you're done with when your device workers on stage, what would you like it to look like or be?
Sure.
Yeah.
So I guess that's kind of where my question kind of falls. Like, well, how do I explore that new territory? Because right now it's existing in my mind as like layered things on top of each other, but not necessarily a performance. So I can understand what structure I perhaps want it to be, but I'm having a hard time. Figuring out the best way to communicate that to the stage.
Right. And so, and are you working with a writer, a director, a dancers, choreographers, musicians?
Yeah, parts of those. Not really a writer, but more so like a actor. So.
And are you doing most of the quote unquote writing?
Yes.
You're doing most of the writing. So yeah. So it's your job, because the writer's job is really we've got to lay that foundation.
Right.
And we've got to create the foundation. That will really, when the other people enter into it, inspire lots of confidence and give them, you know, a nice place to sort of be. Even if it's a devised work, they do appreciate
sure.
I mean, you know, someone has done the basic ground plan. I would say again, you know, index cards on the wall. You know what I mean? And just start writing out. My guess is that do you like, you're a drunkard? Challenge yourself and be okay with being wrong. Yeah, because sometimes when we try new things, we want to be right. You know, it's hard, especially if you're in, you know, really smart. Dramaturgs are wonderfully intelligent. You guys read a lot. You know, no, you're wonderfully intelligent in a way that you know I wouldn't want to be. I think, to be honest. You know, because it's my, you know, a lot. You know, there's a lot going on up there. Ah, like that. As a writer, as an artist, I don't mind when I don't get it right. You know what I mean? Because oftentimes I don't know the right answer. I know just the feeling of it, you know? So when you're trying new things, it's very important to be okay with being wrong or be okay with being not right, okay? Maybe what's holding you back is now you want to get it right. Yeah, I guess I'm, yeah, good. So just be okay, you know? Get yourself some index cards. You like colors? You're wearing pretty colors. Have fun. Get yourself some index cards. You know, get a big, huge honker pack of those wonderful ones that are like green on one side and yellow on the other side. You know, woo-hoo, like that. And just put them all over your wall and just start writing words. Because words are things that anchor. Or shapes, if you want. Mm. Writing things down and just get a whole bunch of push pins. Maybe a big bulletin board or put them right on your wall in your home or your yurt. And... Oh, a yurt is also a home, but you know what I'm saying? You know, and just start sticking, put on some music that you like. Like, what's your favorite song of the moment? Don't say something by Taylor Swift.
I was going to, but that was, I don't.
Taylor Swift? Never gave, oh, no, okay. Well, put on some, whatever you love, put it on and start to tack these things on the wall and start writing out ideas and notions and words and start tacking them on the wall. And it's okay if you don't get it right. It's really okay. All right? And have fun. Yeah. Anybody else? Okay. Thank you, Molly from Dallas. Thank you, all the people from Dallas and all the people from all over who are watching. Thanks, Emerson and HowlRound and Vijay behind the camera. Thank you guys for coming to watch me work and watch me play. Yeah.